I will speak about our museum in Dresden, the Military Historical Museum of the Bundeswehr, and I would like to share with you the general ideas of the redesigning both the exhibition and the architecture of this house that led to the Micheletti Award in 2013. We reopened in 2011. First, our museum, in contrast to most other military historical museums, sees itself primarily not as a museum devoted to the history of technology, but as a historical museum. As a museum without pathos, its purpose is to provide information about our history, to prompt people to ask questions, and to offer a variety of answers, which endeavors to combine reflection on history and critical debate. So it's more a house of encouraging thinking than one attempting to endow meaning. And focused on this objective, it tries to break new ground both in what it contains and how it is constructed. How it is constructed, you may mainly see in the first picture. And the architecture contains a double meaning for us. First of all, certainly to provide new space for exhibits, and secondly, to serve as a symbol. And this symbolic meaning is of special importance for us. The wedge-shaped cut extension cuts through the existing building and its neoclassical architecture that celebrated war in times of national states in the 19th century. Liebeskind's wedge can be seen as a symbol of violence, but also as a symbol against the continuity of war and violence in our history. So it deconstructs our museum as a place of patriotic heroism and opens space and minds to new different perspectives. This idea of multi-perspectivity is also formative for our permanent exhibition, with its branching out into social history and cultural history. Our exhibition is offering many, not only one way to interpret German, but also international military history. The permanent exhibition presents round about 10,000 exhibits on round about 10,000 square meters and is focusing on the human being, the anthropological side of violence. The military is just the famous tip of an iceberg, whose center of gravity is far below the waterline in the field of anthropology and the cultural history of man. The first artistic installation inside the building as a part of the permanent exhibition tries to transfer this focus on human being to the visitor. This installation of Scottish artist Charles Sanderson, which you can see now, shows the two words, love and hate, that are trying to circle each other, changing love to hate and hate to love when encircled, and reflecting so the steady conflict between two principles with many connections to war, politics, and everyday life. And as the words are also projected on the bodies of our visitors, they bring a new dimension to the two-dimensional artwork. The main access to military, two main access of military history are offered to the visitors. We have first a chronological tour in the older part of the building, and we have a thematic cross-section, a theme tour in the new building, in the wedge designed by Daniel Liebeskind. This follows special themes and questions on war and violence through the time up to today. Using the elevator, the visitor can reach the fourth floor of Liebeskind's wedge, and here, 25 meters above the ground, visitors can enter a light-flooded room which offers them a terrific view of probably the most beautiful object of the museum, the Dresden skyline. A town that was destroyed in its center in the last months of World War II, but was also rebuilt in the years and decades after. Thus stressing destruction and reconstruction as a main theme of any museum about war. Here you see the end of the wedge where you can go into and look at the skyline of Dresden. On the third floor, a section called War and Remembrance is represented by three large mobile compactus machines. They show examples of how, who, and what is remembered, and how this remembrance has changed over the time. On the second floor, politics and force, and military and society, with subtopics like military and language, military and music, and military and fashion, go deep in the connections between military and civil culture from past to present. In the fourth subsection, war and play, war is used for exhibition with chairs of merry-go-rounds from the 1960s can be explored. Some kind of predecessors of modern first-person shooters, if you want to. And a doll's house can be found there, a doll's house from a little girl from England that made her dollhouse war fit in 1945. And she did it because of that. This 16-meter-tall V-2 rocket is in our museum tangible in all its ambivalence. When you stand on the ground floor, you see it as a technical marvel. You get information about the construction, the invention, and also about the deaths while building it. And above, where the dollhouse stays, you get the perspective of the victim, of the little girl in England that was attacked by this weapon. And this principle of ambivalence is very important for our museum. This is also backed by the principle of double biographies, repeatedly presenting two different lives with different decisions and different experiences of one event or one period. For example, here you see two men that were very fond of uniforms around the beginning of the First World War, German Kaiser and the Hauptmann from Köpenick. Totally different lives, but they have one thing, they had one thing in common. On the first floor, formation of bodies shows what happened and still happens to humans, both physically and mentally, when entering a military system and becoming integrated in any form of formation. Animals and the military tells the cruel story of the use of animals by humans in times of war, to carry, to reconnaissance, or even as a weapon, often contrary to their nature, supplemented by media explanations with texts, pictures, and films. We tell the whole story of their mistreat. Not only this propaganda perspective of the war comrade, but also the story about their suffering, up to the use of animals in experimental laboratories, where the effects of weapons continues to be tested till today. In suffering from war, the different forms of human suffering can be explored, from injuries to death, and also using human exhibits, like this skull of a soldier that wasn't shot by an enemy, but committed suicide in the last phase of the Second World War. On the ground floor, finally, military and technology show that every single technician invention has the potential of a different use. For example, the simple mechanism of a time clock can be used just to cook eggs accurately for the breakfast, like here with the egg clock, or implemented in a grenade as a time detonator can kill and wound hundreds of people. You just have to decide what to do with any invention. Protection and destruction finally presents the eternal contest between destructive weapons and protective methods and technologies. Standing beneath this arrangement of air attack weapons from different periods, the visitor feels attacked, looking at the weapons threatening him from above. But looking from a higher point of view, you can imagine that from the balcony you see in that picture, and it's possible because of the open space of in Liebeskind Wedge, the visitor becomes an attacker himself. The ambivalence of a weapon and war as a direct experience for the visitor. In contrast, the chronological tour I mentioned before in the old part of the building leads from the Middle Ages to the present day. This part of the museum follows a more classical perspective on history. It is arranged on different levels and offers different depths of information, from highly designed speaking pictures about most important aspects, to cabinets with general overviews on a period, up to knowledge chambers that shed light on subjects such as the economy of war, ideology, strategy, or injury and death. In connection with this exhibition concept, the new design wedge becomes far more than architecture. It becomes something of a social sculpture, as Joseph Beuys would say, where people meet, argue, discuss, learn, walk, eat, and drink. A lively place, you have heard this phrase many times before now, but maybe this is most important for museums. A history workshop, a think tank, all in one, which gives room for people to form their own opinions and to make their own temporary museum. This tank with a knitted covering you see now was a very good example for this concept of a forum for artistically independent expressions and opinions, underlining the disturbing general line of architecture and exhibition, and ironically commenting the tradition of that place as a place of patriotic presentations of powerful weapon technologies. And lastly, making people think of violence, war, and our handling of historical past. Beneath a permanent exhibition, our museum stages variable special exhibitions in different areas, covering historical themes, but also the present. For example, with an exhibition about right-wing violence in Germany, with photographs and stories of committers, former neo-Nazis, and also victims and people who stand against right-wing violence. And supporting the character of the house as an open forum, we certainly offer all kinds of public events accompanying our permanent and special exhibitions, like discussions, film talks, concerts, dance. By the way, the Wedge of Liebeskind has proved to be a perfect surrounding for modern performing arts, and is getting more and more used by artists in Dresden, from Dresden and other towns. Theater, professional theater, is staged, and also non-professional theater projects, like here with former neo-Nazis. Poetry slams, you know that format, and certainly always giving our visitors the chance to speak with each other, with our scientists and our guests. To widen our range, we will open another permanent exhibition in the near future on the Fortress Königstein near Dresden, an exhibition not only on the history of that fortress, it will present a general history of the fortress as a stronghold from former times up to today. And it will again widen the term to new perspectives following concepts of cultural history, as to the fortress as a place to long for in the Romantic era, as a tyrant's castle, as a defensive stronghold against evil attackers, up to concrete uses of its associations, as for example for the US bombers in the Second World War that were named flying fortresses to stress their ability to defend themselves. And also this city will be part of that exhibition, as an example for a city that was able to resist against several attackers, avoiding hostile capture and preserving its autonomous status over centuries, and even after disastrous earthquakes, again so doing in the 90s, despite brutal mortar and artillery attacks from the surrounding hills. Looking back on the process of a conceptual and architectural redesign, I would like to share some experience at the end and some challenges. It proved to be very important to include young progressive scientists in our project to benefit from their new perspectives. It proved to be very important to keep up the primate of science. As you may have noticed, the museum belongs to the army in Germany. So it was very important to stay an open science-based museum and not to become a company museum that mostly has to present official statements. And we were successful. Including art was very important for us, especially when carrying out a concept with a more ambivalent or open approach to events or questions of history. We think that especially modern art, with its inspiring open character, can back you up and can open the minds of your visitors. So don't be afraid of modern art using in your exhibitions. And lastly, finally, we made the experience that in one concept aspect, we had to be excellent indeed. We had to be very convincing. Realizing a quite new concept over a distance of several years, you have to become a kind of a salesman. Maybe you all have encountered this in your professional life. A salesman in the matter of your ideas, every minute, every day, to everybody, from taxi drivers to politicians. And even if you sometimes stay alone, we learn to stand by our ideas, believe in our concepts, and to trust our professional conviction. And we had to bother not so much about juries. They like your concept sometimes, and sometimes they don't like. You don't really always understand that. But do bother about your colleagues. That's important. Also, inside our museum, not everybody was happy with this new concept of military history in the first place. This art project, for example, was nearly mobbed by anonymous notes that were left on the transport boxes. The artwork consists of a huge collection of drawings by a woman with a slight mental disease who till today spends her whole days painting countless pictures, because she believes that only by doing so, she can save the peace of the world. And many said, oh God, what has this to do with military history? With the interpretation of an interpretation or what? And we said, it has everything to do with war and fear and art. And by the way, who can say who's crazier? A woman that believes that she can save the world by painting, or a reality where still weapons of mass destruction can destroy the whole world. And we also found some challenges that keep us busy till today. Maybe you found the same. It's so important to find a balanced proportion of space for permanent and special exhibitions. Today, we would recommend not more than 6,000 square meters for a permanent exhibition, and to use all the rest for your special projects and also for various locations for different forms of events. And don't forget all the professional staff you need to do all the program work you build for. And certainly, we have to constantly advance according to international museum standards of restoration and climate. Because landing objects will become quite difficult, especially landing the very, very expensive objects when you don't. And last, nothing has changed. We have to stay very, very convincing every day, because many of our visitors and guests still are quite surprised by this museum for military history. That's not a patriotic temple of wars that were won, but who tries to be an open forum for the critical debate on war and violence in the past, the present, and the future. Thank you very much.